aside why science declined in Darul Islam and why it did the new science, modern science, did not develop in the Islamic world. I quote some of the well-known speculations and go through them. Some Western scholars have speculated that the reason for the non-development of sciences in the Islamic world was because in the Muslim mentality, everything is attributed to God directly, and there is no room for secondary causes or laws in nature. They say that Muslims didn't believe in the laws of nature, etc., which is false. I was attending a science religion beach conference in Europe, and a physicist stood and said the same thing, that Muslims did not believe in the laws of God in secondary causes. But the important thing is that, the fact is that, they are quoting only one school of theology. All of the Muslim philosophers, without exceptions, and other schools of theology believe in secondary laws, in secondary causes, in Sunanullah, they believe in patterns of God, in laws of nature, they believe. So this is really a false claim. Some Christian scholars have speculated that science developed in Europe and not nowhere else because of the unique features of Christian theology. The leading scientists of 16th and 17th centuries were devout Christians who considered their duty to comprehend God's handiwork. Some scholars have claimed this. One of my colleagues at Oxford was claiming this, a physicist, which is again not true. All of the premises which they quote was necessary for the development of laws of nature was present in the Islamic teachings. And in fact, what they attribute to the founders of modern science like Newton, etc., was said exactly by Biruni, al-Battani, Ibn Haytham, etc. If you read al-Biruni's books, most of them you find in the introduction, that he says he is studying nature, he is studying this science, because that is the way to find the creations of God, creation of God, to find out about the creation of God. So this was the same mentality that Christian scholars like Newton, like Boyle, etc. have. Some Western scholars claim that Muslim scientists lacked the intellectual capacity for innovation and were simply transmitters of knowledge to medieval Europe. The Islamic scientific work was mainly empirical and directed towards practical applications and studies that did not lead to useful results, and those things that did not lead to useful results were discouraged. I am quoting Bertrand Russell, this is very explicit words. Mohammedan civilization in its greatest days was admirable in the arts and many technical ways, but it showed no capacity for independent speculation. In theoretical matters, its importance, which must not be underrated, is as a transmitter. So he is saying that Muslims were simply transmitters of Greek science and Indian science, etc. And they were only doing the practical things, not theoretical things, which is again, I think, not right. Okay, if you look at Khayyam's works, Ibn Haytham works on physics, Khayyam works on algebra, Khwarizmi's work on algebra, Tusi's work on astronomy, you see a lot of innovations. Both Khayyam and Tusi challenged Euclid's fifth century postulate. I have given references in my written notes. Al-Razi wrote a treatise in which he criticized Galen. Ibn Haytham criticized Ptolemy's optics and had innovations, real innovations in the theory of optics, etc. Some writers, Muslim and non-Muslim, claim that modern science did not develop in the Islamic lands because Muslim scientists had a lot of prejudice for their predecessors, heritage, and lacked the courage to go beyond the received view. They talk about the progressive nature of modern science and the stagnating nature of scientific thought in the Arabic Islamic context. They claim that Muslim scientists were conservative, whereas Western scientists were revolutionary. Just to refute this, I make two quotations from Al-Razi and Ibn Haytham. Al-Razi wrote a book, Ash-Shukuk ala Jalinus, and Ibn Haytham wrote a book, Ash-Shukuk ala Batlamus. And in there, in Ash-Shukuk ala Jalinus, Al-Razi says, but the fields of medicine and philosophy do not admit submission to authorities and accepting their views and going along with them and leaving out exploration beyond them. And similarly, a philosopher does not like this attitude from his students or those who learn from him. If you look at the questions that Ibn Sina asked, Biruni asked Ibn Sina, you see very interesting questions, arguing and disputing some of the Aristotelian claims. For example, he says Aristotle believed in a unique universe. Why there should be unique universe? There could be multi-universes, the thing that we are talking about these days in cosmology. Ibn Haytham says Ptolemy assumed an arrangement, that cannot exist. And the fact that this arrangement produces in his imagination the motions that belong to the planets does not free him from the error he committed in his assumed arrangement. For the existing motions of the planets cannot be the result of an arrangement that is impossible to exist. Had this kind of mentality continued and had not been stopped, the Muslim world would have produced modern science. In summary, I believe that the main impetus for the rise of science in Darul Islam was due to the strong urge of the Quran and Sunnah for the study of nature and of rational sciences in the Muslim lands. The weakening of rational sciences due to some internal factors and their mind the Quranic urge and the growth of mysticism of the kind I mentioned, and the division of Islamic lands for their stagnation of rational sciences. To establish a new up-to-date Islamic civilization requires a real return to the strong recommendation of the Quran and Sunnah about the experimental and theoretical study of nature, and not only relying on what West is discovering, accompanied by a real determination on the part of Muslim scientists and rulers to establish such a civilization. Alhamdulillah. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Gulshani, for a very